What's tea, y'all? I know some of you are out there right now having a hard time, having problems in your relationships, having trouble with life. Or maybe you're on social media swiping and swiping, thinking, why can't that be me? Why can't I do that? Well, I'm here to let you know that you can. This is Create Your Own Story with Terrell Garnett, where we not only help you create your own story, but we let you tell yours too. Let's get into it, y'all.
What's good, y'all? I'm back with another podcast. I know y'all missed me, and I have a special guest. And again, I always say that all my guests are special, even the nobodies. Probably shouldn't have said that. But here is my guest, and I'm going to allow him to introduce himself.
What's good, everyone? My name is Pierre Medor. I am a singer, songwriter, producer for the greater part of the last 22 years. I've had the pleasure of working with several artists. My career started with Jagged Edge. From there, I was able to work with Patti LaBelle, Belle Biv DeVoe, Marcus Houston, Omarion, Mary J. Blige, Usher, Rick Ross, Diddy, Sierra, several other names, Andy Irie.
Aren't you looking at plaques on your wall?
I'm like, hold on, let me. Okay, yeah, no, yeah, we've been blessed for that, sure.
That's amazing. So. Now I remember when I went to your home studio with Tamel, and I noticed the Latoya Luckett plaque on your wall. And if anybody knows me, I don't use the word obsessed, but I love Latoya Luckett.
I love Latoya.
I was like, okay, this is a heavy hitter. And then I already knew that you were from the Corner Boys, so I didn't like I just play, you know, I always play cool, you know. I always try to make, you know, act like I don't.
Wait,
know.
When was this? When did,
this is 2014.
Oh yeah. Wow. Okay. Yeah, I do remember that too.
Man. Yeah, that was a minute ago. I ain't been to Atlanta back since either. And Tamel was always telling me I need to fly out there. And sure. Now's the perfect time since tickets is only like $100, like for round trips.
See?
Yeah. But the way that COVID is sitting in the air, I don't know about that.
COVID is in the air, but I tell you, Atlanta's still open as if it's not.
Yeah. So. It's been like that for a minute, I've heard.
Yeah.
The one thing I do want to know about Atlanta is why are they always shooting up the malls?
You know, if I could answer that, I would be the police chief.
Yeah.
You know?
That's for sure. Well, let's just get into some dialogue. Speaking of COVID and everything with, you know, the pandemic and social injustice and everything that we experienced last year in 2020, how has that shaped how you move, how you do things, or just, you know, your vision on life?
Well, COVID hit home for me personally. I had it back in October. Ended up in the ICU for about eight days
Tamel telling me to pray for you.
Yeah, it was very grave. I actually was, I was in an induced coma for the first three days, because of swelling in my brain. Apparently, my experience with it was extreme, you know, so I didn't have the breathing situation so much, but I had other pre-existing conditions with my health that kind of set the backdrop for it to kind of wreak havoc. So it affected me personally in a very real way. And to the extent that it woke me up to like the need to make self-care a priority, taking care of my health. So that has been priority one since I've been home, making sure that I'm making better decisions with my eating, with my rest. You know, those things have been really priority, even above the work and the scheduling. Like the first thing I worked on after I got better was finishing Tamel's project. Yeah. So that was a great step back. But even with that, I was very measured in my time in terms of how much I was measuring it out. You know what I'm saying? So COVID taught me to, or has taught me to prioritize self-care above just my ambition, you know, because if you're not alive, all that ambition doesn't even really matter.
Anything, so,
in the grand scheme of things, just putting health first, personal health first, and everything else aligns after that.
I feel that. And what are your stands on mental health? I know that in the Black community specifically, and in males, it's like a taboo to talk about mental health, you know, and they tell you to just go drink some Robitussin and shut up or something, you know. But mental health is a serious thing that a lot of people deal with, whether it be depression or just other things.
Honestly, my experience with that was even triggered last year. I lost my biological father, and that sent me in an emotional tailspin of sorts. I had to really, I had to go talk to somebody. I had to talk to somebody who wasn't family, who didn't know me, you know what I'm saying? Like, to really just get these thoughts out and also gain some added perspective. As far as mental health, I think within our community, it's a stigma because we think we don't need it. You know what I mean? We think we're above the breakdown. And I mean, what life has taught me is to be humble, you know, and be honest with yourself. You know, when life happens, nothing can buffer that. Yeah. Nothing can buffer you from life happening. Life is going to happen at some point. So when it does, finding healthy ways to express your thoughts and having an authentic exchange is imperative. You know, I would encourage anybody, like, if you're having any issues at all, talk to someone, you know, reach out to somebody and gain some added perspective. I mean, even in that experience, speaking to my counselor helped me realize, you know, things are going to happen, but as long as you're alive, there's hope, you know?
Yeah.
There's hope to make better choices. There's hope to have better experiences, and ultimately hope to persevere through whatever challenges are present.
Yeah, I felt that this year. Last year, during the pandemic and the social injustice, I was pretty chill. I was pretty cool. But then this year, when I had my own experience with the cops over a lie that someone said that I was Yeah, they said that I was with five dudes and Black guys, and that we were following somebody, which all was true. I was with my two underage cousins that are both girls. They had six or seven cop cars pull us over, so I just had to act cool, you know. But like that, took me in a spin of like, dang, you know, you could be doing nothing wrong and still, you know, can happen.
Yeah.
That had me down for about like a month or so, and I just remember hearing this song years ago by Jay Moss called I don't know what the song's called, but in the song he talks about how sometimes he feels like his faith isn't strong enough, and for the first time that's kind of how I was feeling. Like, usually my faith can get me through anything else, but I felt like, okay, well, maybe my faith ain't strong enough right now. But I soon snapped out of it, or, you know, talked to people, and felt better.
How did you actively handle that? Did you go and speak to like a licensed therapist, or did you just find her?
So my day job, I'm not gonna name them because they don't get deserve no credit, but my day job offers free counseling and stuff, so I was able to through the insurance, I should say, I was able to speak to somebody in regards to that. But it's even hard in itself, that, because you're speaking to somebody, and for me, even like with doctors and stuff, I prefer them to be Black, just for the simple fact, not to say that any other race doctors is not going to be good, it's just that I need you to understand what I'm going through. And if you're not Black for some things, like, I can tell you and express to you how I feel, but if you really don't get it, there's nothing that I can do to make you understand.
I totally get that. Yeah, you got to have the perspectives balanced out, for sure.
Yeah. But I'm good now. I had paused my podcast for a little while, and I after that I hit the ground running, and you know, never
well,
looked
we're
back.
happy. We're definitely happy you're back.
Yes,
For sure, bro.
thank you. I appreciate that, because you never know, like life, like it could be one little thing and it just sets you back, and you didn't even think that it would affect you as much as it did. So even
Absolutely.
to what you were saying about your father, I think about that often too, because my dad's never really been in my life. And I'm like, well, if he passed away, how would I feel? Like, I could easily say that it wouldn't bother me, but I won't know unless it happens.
Yeah, I can honestly say there's nothing that prepares you for the loss of a parent, and it's like, it's a real juggernaut for sure. And couple that with, you know, because of the pandemic rules, right? We in that period of time, you couldn't have funerals.
Yeah,
they weren't allowing gatherings, so we literally just memorialized my father this past summer on his birthday. You know, on what would have been his 50th birthday. You know, 50,
he died young.
So crazy, man.
Yeah. Well, I'm really sorry to hear that happened. To get into some more actually, before we get into some more dialogue, so on my podcast, I always play music. And if there's an artist or somebody on, I always play something of theirs. And it was really hard to pick something. I had several songs, and I usually only play three. And I'm like, should I go old? Should I be new? And then I was like, there, I have a whole bunch of unreleased stuff, like, you know, like from different artists.
Wow.
And I'm like, should I? Like, so I've been debating. I'm going back. Like, I have a list right here. You can't see it because of the camera, but there's a list of songs that I'm going to play or whatever. But
okay. This
one I'm going to play, it's one of my favorite records. It's by George Arang.
Oh.
And it's the remix or part two, I Do, featuring Louis Guy, aka Sickpin. So, and you produced this record. And
yes,
funny
sir.
Story about this record. I don't know, the record's really old, right?
Yeah, I think it definitely had some history.
Yes, okay, so I heard the record. I went to the studio with her when she was out here in LA in like 2013. And she played some record, and she played this particular record. And I'm like, oh, that's amazing. So literally every year, I'm like, when you going to release it? When you going to release it? And like 5 years later, so she actually released the record. So it's one of my favorite songs. Like, I don't believe in getting married. But if I ever got married, this would be played at my wedding.
I love it.
Here we go.
I'd stay down with you, babe, even if you were broke. Look at how far we came. Imagine how far we'll go. I guess I might have misplaced the pain, 'cause it seems to be gone. And I think that you're the one to blame, making all this right from wrong.
Baby, I'm your girl. Boy, do you believe? Oh,
when I say I love you, that means I do. When I say forever, believe me, it's true. Oh, who needs a ring if I don't have you? Don't wanna know nothing but a cool. When I say I
girl, I hear the words you say, and I hope that they're true. 'Cause I don't wanna open up just to get robbed by you. But I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt.
Ooh.
'Cause I don't think that's what you about. So when you tell me you love me,
I'ma believe
it. Till that day we say we do.
Just keep it true.
Are you saying that you're cool? And if my money ain't right, you ain't gon' run out.
Oh,
if you
guys can get that record now on Apple Music or Spotify. That's Georgia Rae and I Do featuring Sick Pen, a.k.a. Lewis Sky, produced by
Pierre. So good.
Yeah, that song is everything. Everything. So just to get back into some conversation, so you were with a Grammy-nominated group, Corner Boys.
Yeah.
How was the transition of, you know, the disbandment and then going off to do, you know, your other stuff with Rico Love and just, you know, on your own? How was the transition in that?
Well, honestly, well, with you brought up Rico Love. Rico Love was kind of really the third member of the Corner Boys, if you want to be honest. No, but, well, you would think that, yeah, for sure, because we were all close-knit, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But Corner Boys originally was myself in D-Town and then two writers, our partner Daniel Moore, who's gone on to be MD for any and everybody, but yeah. Currently Mariah Carey's yeah. MD, and our former manager, he was also a writer at the time, Tyrell Bing. He was the other writing component. And so it was the four of us working together. So the thing is, at times, even in the beginning of the Corner Boys, you know, the writing faction would get called in by other producers to write on other situations. So, you know, there was kind of like a natural, I don't want to say separation, but we would all kind of work. We just work with whoever, however, you know, makes collaboration sense. Has always been a part of our fabric, I guess you could say. And as far as, so eventually D-Town and I kind of ventured off, did our own thing. And then Tyrell came back in the picture and that at that point serving as our management. And then, you know, as time went on, as most partnerships do, you know, we kind of just outgrew the routine of it, I guess you could say. I know me personally, I got to a place where I just kind of wanted to just explore some other things and kind of spread my wings a little bit for sure. And so it was kind of an organic growing into our own spaces, so to speak. But the relationships have always been, you know, a phone call away. We all still will see each other from time to time and whatnot. The relationship with Rico resurfaced some years after we went our separate ways to the point where we were all able to come back and work together again. D-Town was a part of that as well, down there in Miami with Division One. Mm-hmm. And he's still working alongside Rico. And so they got a lot of great things going on over there at Division One. And yeah, so it's been kind of a natural progression into our own respective spaces, you know.
I love that.
Yeah.
So I asked this question, and it's funny because I feel like the artists, well, I've only asked it twice so far, but Candace and Tony both got kind of stumped in a sense about the question. So if you could be in the Guinness Book of World Records for any song that you've done, what song would be in there?
What song would be in there? I guess, I don't know. That's a tough question. I can see why they would get stumped. I mean, you have different songs that perform differently. Mm-hmm. And like, I don't know if that becomes the criteria and how we measure which song should be in the Guinness Book of World Records.
What would you put in there? Your personal favorite?
That's tough too, because all of these records are my children. I love them all.
As you look at your plaques.
No, I'll be honest though. One that was kind of like a surprise for me anyways, because I wasn't familiar with the genre before working with this particular artist, Romeo Santos, who was a huge, you know, bachata artist and from the group Aventura. And I had no clue about just how huge his impact was. And when I did my homework before working with him, I was like, whoa, okay, so we're going in with a legend. I had no idea of what to expect in the creative process, but that song has performed exceptionally well, you know, throughout the years. And yeah, that was probably one of my biggest moments. And I was able to do that alongside Rico Love. Mm-hmm. Rico tagged me in, brought me into that situation, and gave me the opportunity to be a part of that experience. That was like huge. That's like amazing. I remember one memory I'll share is that, you know, being in the middle of American Airlines Arena in Miami at the time. I think it's called something else now, but the arena downtown, and he sold out. Romeo Santos showed up, sold out that show, sold out the arena for three nights in a row. We went to see him perform, and I swear he didn't have to sing one word of any song top to bottom. His fans are like amazing, like super devout, loyal. Like they knew every word. That was mind blowing to hear your song being sang.
Yeah.
By, you know, 10,000 voices at the same time.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
So my next question for you is, what mistake / lesson do you feel that you learn consistently? Meaning that, you know, you keep making the same mistake, even if you stop making it now, but something that you had to learn over and over again until you got it.
There's so many. Let me think. Hold on.
I feel it.
You know, I don't. Well, here's the thing. I don't believe in mistakes per se. Like theoretically speaking, I know they're a thing. I think that things happen through providence and through intention most times. Because even things we call mistakes are things that we meant to do in the moment. Yeah. You know. But what I would take from your question is like, what lesson continues to reoccur is valuing the differing nature of relationships. Like every relationship that you're in is not a 50-50 thing. You know, learning to respect whatever the alchemy of the relationships in your life that work organically. Like, and sometimes they work because it's 70-30, but that 30 is sweet. You know what I'm saying? And it helps make up for whatever's missing in that 70. Learning how to appreciate every relationship, no matter what the amount of the contribution. I think that's been a consistent lesson. Because there's been times where, you know, I felt like maybe effort wasn't the same or reciprocal. Or maybe it was reciprocal, but not equally matched,
yeah,
if that makes sense. But that didn't mean that the relationship itself didn't work. You know, it's just sometimes our expectations going into our relationships are beyond people's capacity. You know what I'm saying? And I think that is something we have to be self-aware enough to recognize what we bring to the table and also what others bring to the table, and be okay when it's, you know, when it doesn't meet your expectations, knowing how to navigate in and out of those spaces, you know, as needed.
Yeah, that's something that I've realized more so lately. And I'm like, I've ended relationships because I wasn't getting what I necessarily needed out of the relationships. And then realizing that like, that person's just not able to give that. So I should be content with them not being able to give that and get what I need from somebody else or something, you know, or something else for that matter.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but the relationship's dead and gone now.
Listen, but I mean, just the thought that, you know, we're all here for a relationship. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's like, I think that's telling in and of itself. Like, no matter how much any of us wants to be just completely independent, isolated on our own, we're all inherently built for a relationship.
Yeah.
You know?
Definitely.
But knowing how to, like, you know, like you said, do the proper accounting. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I wasn't accounting properly. I was giving too much to people that didn't deserve that, in a sense, but at the same time, if that's just me, I shouldn't be upset with me giving so much and then them taking it, because that's just me. So regardless if they were going to be, you know, reciprocal or mutual with what I was giving, they're matching the energy, I still was going to do it regardless. So there's no reason why I should be upset if they're not giving what I want them to be giving.
I do think there's something to that, though. When you're built like you are, like to be extremely generous, I think that in those cases, you have to make sure. I'm the same way with certain respects. It's like, but finding the people that fill us up in the same, to the same extent that we give.
Yeah.
That's imperative.
Yeah, I know. It's funny. The other day, Tamel had hit me up and she's like, oh, can you fix this on my website? And I sent her this thing that I seen, and I was waiting for her to ask for something just so I could send this a meme. And the meme basically said, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be able to help you make more money while I don't make any anymore. And I was just waiting for it. She's like, you know, I would pay it. I was like, I'm just joking. I care less if you pay me or you don't pay me, because I'm not doing it because I'm going to get money out of it. Like, we have a good relationship. We're friends. And like, I like helping. So, but I just needed to send it because I thought it was hilarious.
You needed somebody to get that off.
Yeah.
You were like, yeah, first person asked me for something.
Exactly.
I'm black. I love it.
Like, I asked this question before, and the person that I asked it to, I felt was a little dense, so they didn't understand the question. So I'm going to try it again. But if happiness were a coin, what would you do to get rich? So if happiness was money, what would you do to get rich? Because, I mean, we all out here trying to make money or trying to, you know.
If happiness was money, what would I do to get rich?
Yeah.
I guess I would just set my intention on that and that alone. If it was coincided with that, you know. But happiness, I think, where you would send me off on a tangent is the notion of happiness, because I think that is so elusive anyway. You know what I'm saying?
Do you believe that happiness comes with success?
No, I don't think that. I don't think that they are conjoined. Yeah. You know what I mean? I think that happiness is its own construct, that over time you learn how to dwell in that space, because it really does come down to just making a decision on what state you want to be in. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Versus allowing it to be something that is just you're incessantly chasing, you know, the notion of happiness. Like, defining what happiness looks like or what it is something that I think is subjective to each and every one of us,
just like for us to define,
you know?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Just like success, just like what I may find successful, you may not find successful.
Yeah,
true. So it really just depends on the person. If you can give anybody a piece of advice that would change their life, what would it be?
Be honest with yourself. Be honest with yourself so you can truly be rooted in your own authenticity. And I think that everything amazing and beautiful about life is, it blossoms from authenticity.
I feel that. I agree. Speaking of authentic, so I know I'm not going to play any songs right now by her, but I had this, every podcast I bring her up because I'm speaking it into fruition. So back in January, when I first started this Create Your Own Story podcast, the first episode I did, I was talking to my cousin on the podcast, and I was like, yeah, my dream guest would be to have on there is Samo. Like, 2 months later, I actually got him on the podcast, and I'm like, oh, snaps. Like, it happened so fast, but I didn't take it in. I didn't appreciate it as much because I felt like it came so easy and it came so fast that I didn't appreciate it as much as I felt like I should have, or, you know? But I say that to say, Brandy's going to be on the podcast. She doesn't know it yet.
Ooh.
She don't know it yet.
There we go. Okay.
But no, I'm speaking into an existence.
Listen, I'm not in the way. I'm here to agree. Yes. Listen, you're manifesting.
Exactly. I was telling Tony the same thing. We had like part of the podcast was we were just talking about Brandy and how. So I've met Brandy, and I've met a lot of people over the years with, you know, Sky and Tamel or K Michelle, or, you know, just been in certain rooms. And I'm just like, I wish that I was doing something besides helping them out then, like for myself, so I could have, you know, capitalized on the opportunities that I had in front of me, you know? But I mean, I got you on the podcast, and, you know,
I'm
so,
saying, look at you now, though.
So it's not for nothing, but Brandy, I was able to be in a room with her and actually got to speak to her. And I was like nervous, and I was about to leave the end of the little kickback that was for Valentine's Day. And I'm like, I gotta say something before I leave. Like, this is like a once in a lifetime thing. Yeah. So I was able to go up to her and talk to her for a couple minutes, tell her that she was like the first celebrity that ever messaged me back on Twitter. And then she ended up following me. But back then, Instagram wasn't even out yet. So I'm like, dang, why couldn't it have been Instagram? That's how long ago it was. So fast forward, like, 10 months, I actually met her mom on Christmas Eve at the, what was that? The Topanga Mall. They were buying stuff on Christmas Eve. And my friend at the time wanted to go there. And I thought that he wanted to go there to get a last minute Christmas gift. So we drove all the way over there. Turns out he just wanted to see some celebrities. So I was super irritated. Like, you know, I was like, really? That's like, just funny. Go to Roscoe's if you want to see some celebrities. Like, there's going to be somebody there.
He knew exactly where to go.
No, though. He really did.
He knew they'd be out.
And he's like, well, I don't see any. And I was like, well, there's Mrs. Norwood, Brandy's mom. He's like, that ain't her. And I'm like, yeah, it is. And I was like, Mrs. Norwood. And she literally, when I tell you, she grabbed my hand and we're literally walking through the mall talking, holding hands. And like, when you watch, if you watch the Ray J and Brandy show, I forget what the show's called. Like, she was really hard on them, and, like, she just gave, like, a harder exterior. So I thought that if I ever met her, that's how she would come off. But when I say she's the sweetest person.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the sweetest person. We were just talking, holding hands or whatever. And then I needed to go to Macy's, but I know that she was in Macy's. And I was like, well, I don't look like a stalker, so I'm just not going to go to Macy's. But oh, I believe, from what I know, I believe Brandy and Ray J were in Macy's. But I didn't want to seem like a stalker, so I didn't even go inside.
But you were already holding her hand.
Yeah, but
it would have been nothing to just continue the trip.
That's true. But so you worked with Brandy on her 2011 album. It was basically like her comeback album in a sense, because I know that she stated before that she didn't care for the Human album that happened prior to. But the 2011 album was freaking amazing. Still to this day, you can listen to every song. So how was it to be in the room with her and vocal produce and work with her?
Man, Brandy, working with Brandy, first of all, that brought out my inner child giddiness. Like, you know, she's just, she's somebody you've been listening, if you've been listening since you were a child, you know, you just like, you know that voice, you love that voice, you love everything that she does. And so now when I found myself in that place where, man, I'm about to work with Brandy. It was like, it was a real moment. It was a real moment. I won't front. So I had, in that season of time, I was working with Rico Love in Miami, and he was like, hey man, we're getting ready to go in the studio with Brandy, start working on records. Little did I know I would end up engineering her, like recording her, you know what I'm saying? And man, when I tell you, it was like an amazing, amazing experience. Like, her voice is every bit as enchanting as you would imagine. And her personality is so, like, it's just so colorful and dope. You know what I mean? Like, she was amazing. That's all I can, like, oh, so when I started recording her and the first time I heard her like sing on the mic, I was just like, oh my, under my breath, I'm like, oh my God, like, I'm having a complete like meltdown within and trying to still keep my professional composure, because I was just like, yo, nah, this is, you know, up to that point, I've worked with female artists, And I always would try to get them to sing like her, you know, but to be with the real thing, it was like, yes.
And I said on the podcast with Tony, and after I said it, I'm like, oh, I know Monica ain't going to do my podcast no more because of what I said. And I'm going to say it again because I stand by what I said. And it wasn't bashing Monica at all. But what I was saying was I could understand if there was still a beef, why there was still a beef. Because when have you ever heard any singer in everdom say that the reason why they started singing or wanted to sing was because of Monica? But everybody says that about Brandy.
I definitely have songs with Monica too.
I'm not shading Monica. I think she's amazing. No, I've seen her several times in concert.
I get what I'm saying.
Though. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I get your point. There's a level of virtuosity that Brandy possesses that is just, it's unmatched. I don't put anybody in a category with her from a vocal ability standpoint. She's a one of one. There is, I've not heard anybody with that. I've heard other people with virtuosity and control, but it's not that. Like, what makes Brandy special that people, I don't think they would ever really get or understand. It's her connectivity. It's, you know, her rhythmic sensibility, you know, all of that being infused into just a high level of singing intellect. You know, she knows how to bring a song to life. It's not just the vocal release or the runs that she's doing, you know, it's like a real intentional, I want to make you feel this way. And she does it every time without fail, you know?
So out of the records that you guys did with her, which one was your favorite?
It's a tie between Paint This House and Hardly Breathing.
Hardly Breathing is mine. I love Hardly Paint This House too.
Hardly Breathing was like, oh my God. Cause that, I mean, on Paint This House, I just contributed to, I engineered Paint This House and I did the music on the bridge. That was my contribution to that musically. Hardly Breathing was a track I was able to co-create. So, yeah, I would say it's a tie between those two in terms of how they make me feel, you know?
All right, well, let's play. I wasn't going to play Hardly Breathing. But, you know, let's get into that because I could hear it in my head right now. So I want to hear it now.
I'm surprised you're not singing along with these two. Most videos when I see you, you're like singing.
Dead.
It's always a quick video of you like singing Dead. The song at the yes. top of your lungs.
Yes, at the top. I swear, if I had the ability to be, like, if I was vocally gifted, it'd be a problem for these R&B niggas. I'm just telling you right now.
I already know.
But with a little autotune, you know, I ain't never hurt nobody.
Listen, it's been saving folks since it was in existence.
Yes, definitely. # Britney Spears. But here's Hardly Breathing.
Take you back. It's killing me watching you walk. gave you many times along the way. Yeah, yeah. But mama said don't trust him.
Record.
Oh my god.
I actually have a playlist that I released on the 27th of or the 28th of February dedicated to Brandy. It's called Terrell Garnett Presents the Vocal Bible. That song's actually on that on that playlist. There's 28 songs. 27 years she's been in the business, and I added an extra song because, you know, just cause.
That's love.
Yeah. That's real love. I think she did like one of the posts. I believe she did see it, but I don't know if she looked at the track list and everything, but it took me a minute to put that together. Cause I was like, and then to place the songs where, like, I swear I should be in the industry.
Are you not in the industry?
I am, but I'm not, you know, like don't get me wrong. I've helped artists. Like for instance, with Akili, that was a part of Melrose, like on her project that she, you know, I picked one of the songs to go on there. I mean, Tamel always sends me stuff or whatever to see what I think of it. And then I've helped Sky out. So I'm like, I've helped K Michelle too.
Come on, man. You're a tastemaker, man.
Yeah, I guess so. I always say though, like the people that I gravitate to, just in the music, like I know talent. If I don't know nothing else, I know talent. I know when someone's going to be big, so. And that's testimony to Mel's album EP went number one. And then K Michelle is, you know, doing big things now. And I found out these people before, you know, they made it big. I remember I found actually a song that she gets, how I found Tamel. And I'm going to play one of her songs later because I know if I don't, she's going to tell me something. It's Ready for Love. I remember hearing like a lot of her songs leaked online, and I remember Ready for Love, and I remember she sang it on YouTube, and this was 2008, maybe 2009. And I messaged her on YouTube, and we built a relationship off of that, and then I hadn't talked to her in like maybe 6-7 months, and then she had a Twitter, but she never got on Twitter, so I was just like, well, if you ever see this, you know, I hope you're doing well. And she hit me back maybe a week later talking about, well, I'll be in L.A. in February. Like, I would love to, you know, kick it or meet. And that's how I met her and Sky the same day. We ended up going to Roscoe's. And, we've been close ever since. So
I love it.
Stuff like that. I mean, I don't know if stuff like that happened. That was way before, like, social media was really, like, as big as it is now. There was no Instagram.
I was thinking about it today. Do you remember LimeWire?
Yes, that was my thing. So when I was in high school, like 15, 16 years ago, that's how I used to make money. I used to make CDs for everybody, and I would put playlists together, and I would make money off of that. LimeWire and BearShare. Speaking of those days, I know that you worked with Tanisha Kelly and the big song. I mean, it's a big fan favorite song with the Wish. What is it? Wish.
I Wish You Love Me.
Thank you. However, there's like three different versions, and I remember hearing a version from a girl group, and I remember it was on MySpace, and I didn't, and I used to rip stuff off of MySpace all the time, but I don't know. I know I ripped it off of there, but I cannot find that record, that version of it. Oh, I have the one from, what's her name, LaShay Martin?
LaShay Martin, okay, so backstory. LaShay Martin is the original, person who demoed the record. She sang it the first time.
I have the demo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I can play it if you want, but yeah, I have the demo. Yeah. And I remember her because she was on Making the Band.
Yes. She was amazing. First of all, LaShae Martin's she's one of the dopest vocalists I've ever worked with, for sure.
Yeah, so dope. But I have a lot of unreleased stuff by her. I miss that, like, I'm pretty sure the artists don't miss it, but I miss the days when the songs used to leak online.
Yeah, there was something to it, right?
Yeah.
It kind of created like a mystique about,
exactly,
you know, or being able to have a niche, you know, and just...
Yeah, because I mean, like, a lot of Tamel stuff leaked, but there was no pictures of her. So you just had to kind of guess, like, what she looked like. Mm-hmm. And I mean, like, at least over 100 songs leaked by her. And just stuff by, like, one that you guys done with the One Chance. Like, just to name just a few artists, but, like, it's just, you know, it's crazy. I don't know how they were leaking, but they...
You know, in those days, it was like, okay, so maybe, like, the early 2000s, we wouldn't even send music via email. It was like you would pull up on somebody with a CD. Like you said, mm-hmm. you used to burn CDs. Yeah. And then, you know, once email really, really kind of took off, or people were sending MP3s via email, it was like all of a sudden all of this music started leaking. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know, man. I mean, if I had... It would be crazy if you had compilation albums of all the songs that didn't see the light of day.
A lot of the songs that didn't make are usually better than the ones that did make the albums.
There's a lot of goodness, and I'm just thinking about
AR. The thought that this was across,
like, across the board with all, like, the amazing producers that we love. Imagine how many of their records haven't even seen the light of day, you know? Yeah,
well, I got a lot. Like, it's funny, though, because Tamel, I don't know, I think she probably was in the studio with you one time and was like, hey, can you send me a record? Can you send me, what was one of the ones she said? I can't even think, because she wanted to remake it or do something with it. I can't even think of it.
I'm going to say, were you the one that sent Ready for Love? Because one day,
I did send that.
I needed her to find it, and she... somehow manifested it. So I mean, yeah, that must have been you.
Yeah, it was definitely me. I have pretty much all the records she don't have.
Sheesh.
I'm just a music connoisseur.
That was like Ready for Love was like maybe the third or fourth record I worked on with Tamel. Mm-hmm. And we literally sat in the studio and wrote that song together. Like, just sat at the piano.
I keep telling her she needs to redo it.
Oh no, it's gonna make a resurgence. Yes. It's gonna make a comeback. Absolutely.
Because
it's
still years. Even like with the Loving You record, I kept telling her, I was like, oh, you need to do, because she Minnie Whippleton's Loving You. And she's like, ah, nah. And then somebody else tells her, and then she goes and does it. I said, okay. You just needed a second opinion, I guess.
You see? Listen, trust Terrell.
Seriously, she knows. She'll be like, yeah, I know, you told me before. And I was like, yeah, okay. As long as you know.
See?
But my favorite question that I ask everybody is, if you had 10 minutes with God, what would be the one question you would ask him?
Man, I would need God to explain to me, what is this free will about? Why? You know, like, just the concept to me that just, you know, and maybe it's just a theological concept, right? In and of itself, but like, if that's supposed to be the inception of all things going awry with humanity at large, or you know, I would want to know, like, why, you know, especially if you knew God is omniscient, he knows everything the way that it's laid out, right? Mm-hmm. Or the way that it's alliterated and taught to us, that, you know, if you knew all of that, why? You know, I would need, I would want to know that. You know what I'm saying?
That's an amazing question. No, but usually 9 times out of 10, any, like, whether it's a celebrity or just a regular day person, they always ask about their purpose. So to hear something different is refreshing. This, if they're on the right track.
Well, you know, I guess, I can see why people ask that, because most people are, Or most people tend to feel in the blind with respect to it. Because even knowing it, there's still there's still the desire to know, like, okay, even once you know your purpose, it's like, well, all right, now how?
Yeah.
I know what, but now how do I live in my purpose? Or, you know, like, how do I live out my purpose? But purpose, I think, is like one of those, man, that's one of those forever giving subjects, right?
Yes. I feel like I'm just with the podcast. I remember telling, I had Crystal Tamar from Sophia Fresh on here. Mm. And I was saying to her that I've always wanted to work in the music industry of some sort when I was young, and I wanted to have my own show. And she's like, oh, well, you're doing that now. Like, you're doing both. And I'm like, oh, shit. Like, I didn't even realize, like, I am helping out new artists and stuff like that, playing music, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm have my own show. Like, I didn't realize it. And I'm like, oh, snaps. Like, you're telling the truth. I really am doing that right now. So
That's the funniest part about manifestation. Yeah. I've heard you, first of all, I've heard you say this a few times throughout our conversation today. So this is what comes to me, is like realizing how powerful our words and our confessions are. It's like, if you say it, it's as good as done.
Yeah.
If you say it and it's a pure intention, like it's genuinely in your heart and you speak it, it's as good as done, you know?
Yeah. So I'm going to speak more. People, LaToya Luck is going to be on the show. I'm scared. Absolutely. But no.
I love LaToya too. LaToya was one of the first artists that I was able to
with the Noontime, right? Yeah,
even before Noontime.
Well, you need to get back in the studio with her, because she talking about she not really wanting to make music right now. I'm like, you don't want to make music. Why do we gotta suffer? I don't think
she has such a beautiful voice.
She really does, and just so you need to hit her up, get her in studio, because we need some more music. And she's gone through something in her relationship, so I know that the music's good. Usually when it's like the Mary J effect, when people go through something, the music just hits. Yeah, it's better, especially when it's R&B. But how was it working with Mary J?
That was another career highlight. That was another fan. I had a real fanboy moment in that session too. But at that point, I kept it a little more composed, because I didn't want to be a complete cornball. But man, Mary actually gave me a compliment. She was like, she was really happy with how she was sounding in the recording process, you know. Most people in the recording process, it can be a little rough. You're not really trying to make it sound too good, I guess, so to speak. But part of our workflow and process is to create a comfortable environment for the artists so that they can give their best performance. And so that was one of the highlights, man. And just watching her in her zone, like, it's Mary, like, it's the queen.
I've seen
it's
her.
The queen, like, and she has that. She has, I would say, her and Alicia Keys to me were two of like the most regal experiences, in terms of when you come in a room with them, they just, their essence is so voluminous, like it fills up the room. You know?
Amazing. Yeah, I've seen Mary live 2 or 3 times. I really want to say three, but I think it was 2. And both times LaToya opened for her. So it was a 2-for-1 special. I drove, the first time I drove 6-7 hours to go see it. Just to see, I really went for LaToya. And my mom wanted to see Mary. I'm just going to be honest. Like, and then I was like, oh, dang, Mary's good. Like, you know, but that was when she was in her, like, happy in her marriage or whatever. And then I seen her at her last tour, where she was going through the divorce. So, like, even at both, like, extremes, she's still so amazing. And, like, it's like going to church, I feel. Like, that's the only way I can describe it, because she gives a message and it makes you, like, look back at your life. Like, dang.
She's so unselfish in her art. She just, like, really gives all of what she has to offer, man. And that's why we love her, though.
Yeah.
That's why she is who we is. I think with respect to artists, I think those are the artists that are most loved, I think, are the ones that just give of themselves unselfishly.
Yeah, I think that out of all of them, the person that I probably would want to have the interview with the most is Janet Jackson, though.
Ooh, that would be a good one.
It's just because I look at people like performances on YouTube, but with Janet Jackson, I look at her interviews. Yes. Because I learn from how to ask certain questions because I see how she dodges certain questions. And it's like so effortlessly, like you didn't even realize that she dodged it. Like she answered it without answering it.
She's from the illustrious Jackson family.
Exactly.
They made sure they were prepared, man.
Yeah, so
Joe Jackson did his thing, man.
No, yes, RP to him, but I really want to be able to get words like raw, even if it's never even recorded or no one ever hears it, just to have certain dialogue with her, like where her be vulnerable and open, that would be amazing. Because she done seen some things and been through some things.
Oh, yeah. Now, the key is getting her to talk about it.
Yes, that's the key. So if I ever, yeah, I'm just going to ask it.
When I.
So before I ask you some more questions, I said I was going to play Tamel. So I'm going to play two songs. So the EP, I was like going through and I'm like, what song do I want to play? Because they're all amazing. But I feel that the record I'm going to play was the single. And I have a cameo in the video, if you've seen the video.
Yeah. No, I saw it.
Soon As. And the reason I'm playing this particular record is because, I don't know, just something about it. It just feels good. Like, this sounds like a timeless record. And nowadays, when you hear music, you don't hear any more. You really don't hear timeless records that much. Not often.
Man, before you ring off with that, we got to give a shout out to Chuck E. Thompson, who just recently passed away. Who we sampled his record. Yeah, those are his chords. In there, that's his DNA in that record. So much love and respect to him. He's definitely been one of the patriarchs of R&B that we stand on his shoulders for sure.
Yes, I'm gonna play the record now, Soon As, and you guys might know the sample because it was sampled Faith Evans' song Soon As I Get Home, which is everybody's favorite song. So here we go, Soon As.
What you waiting for? I told you soon as I put a foot in the house. Don't even open your mouth. You should be taking me down. Don't wanna hear no excuses. Don't wanna hear your mouth, cause I got reasons. Give me the letter that I need, I'm throwing the deuces. I've been gone for too long. Only thing on my mind is getting some love when I'm home. Boy, I got dressed down, I had to go to work. I know you work too, cause both of us are grinding. But at the end of the day, I know for certain. When I get home, I'ma put that overtime in.
But that particular one just feels good. It's a what you would say like a barbecue record.
Yeah,
like you just, you know, you're gonna dance, you're gonna sing to it. It's gonna be played at the barbecue.
Listen, Tamel's vocals. Oh, that's another one, man. I'm so lucky that, you know, I get to work with her regularly. Like, we've been in the paint since like 08, maybe even earlier. I think I met Tamel in 2006. Dang. When she first moved to Atlanta, you know, fresh
out of high school.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, so when I tell you, that relationship has just been one of my favorites for my entire career since then, you know?
Yeah, mine too. I mean, out of all the people I've met, like, it's just genuine. Like, she's very
genuine. That's the word.
Yeah, you got genuine.
That's the word.
Very genuine. So, like, what you see is what you get, and, like, yes. You know. And it's just, it's an easy relationship to maintain.
Always.
Yeah.
Always, yeah.
So it's a testament of her and her character and how she raised. Shout out to her mom and her dad. But with everything, like, I've been in the studio with Tamel several times, and it's so funny. I remember, I forget who we were in the studio with, but the producer was like, dang, like, you got a cheat code, Tamel. Like, there's something about you. And I'm never going to forget that, because, like, just there's notes that, like, she can hit, and I just can't wait till people actually are able to see her live. Like, listening to music is one thing, but actually being able to hear her sing, or even if it's just we're on the phone talking and she just starts singing, it's like, it's just...
You said it. It's the fluidity of how easily, like, all of that, it's nothing for her. Yeah. Like, it's just... flows, one of a kind voice, man.
Yes, I know. One of my favorite songs that you guys did, I don't know why I'm drawing so many blanks today. I'm using not this, because it was never released, so most of her stuff ain't. So hold on, I'm gonna tell you what the song's called right now. Ain't Gotta Worry.
Oh yeah, that's another good one.
Yeah, that record right there. And there's like, and she had sent me both versions, and I'm just I don't even know which one to choose. Like, cause, like, I'm like, well, if you take part of the second verse of this one, put it with the first verse of this one, and then mix the bridge, like. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But that record is amazing, and it'll probably never see the light of day.
Who knows? You know, there's always chance for these records to have life in the future. I mean, I think that's a testament to great writing, that, you know, you can always pick it back up. One thing about it, you can always take a greatly written record and reproduce it.
That's true.
You know,
I'm telling you, Ready for Love need to come back out. But I said I was gonna play two songs by Tamel, and that's actually gonna be the second one, just because I feel like it's nostalgic, and it's one of those songs that, and I keep telling her, I was like, like, you have so many fans that don't know who you are off of this record alone, that once you play the record, they're going to be like, oh, snaps, you sing that, like, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah, that song had a cult following, didn't it?
It, like, really did, though.
Just a little underground cult following.
It's just because, and it came out around the same time as I Wish You Loved Me by Tanisha.
Yes.
This one, of course, got leaked, whatnot, but... it's just something about the record that I feel like it was kind of like, for women at least, it's like one of those records that, you know, who doesn't want to be loved, and like, who's ready for it?
It's even, that coming of age, falling in love, and or wanting to fall in love record.
So I'm going to play that. I ain't heard the song in a minute either.
Me either. Let's go. Let's take the trip.
Right?
Come home to the same man, sleep in the same bed every night. I wanna know a relationship, free from petty arguments or silly senseless fights. I want the kind of love that my grandparents shared, once in a lifetime or so rare. I still believe in the possibility that there's someone who's out there for me. I need to trust with everything in me. Free from my insanity. Tired of games, think I'm ready for change. Run around the circles, I've been seeing the same thing. Searching for something different, baby. Ready for love. Tired of games, think I'm ready for change. Run around the circles, I've been seeing the same thing.
It's the way she comes out of that bridge for me.
Yes, I had to play the whole. I had to pray to the bridge. Yeah, so she definitely gonna have to recut that, even if it's just, you know, I don't know. Some of these art, like a lot, I feel like a lot of these artists are trying to keep up with the times. I'm not saying Tamela's, but some of these are trying to keep up with what's hot right now. But yeah. I noticed that, like, the people that are staying authentic to themselves, like the Toni Braxtons or the Brandys and stuff like that, are actually, like, you know, like Toni Braxton just had a number one single last year off of the. So, I mean, like, if you stay true to yourself, it's there's a testament to that. And again, being authentic instead of. So my next question for you, I'm almost done, but my next question for you is, what is your self-worth based on?
My self-worth is based off of understanding that I'm here for a reason, that I've been afforded an opportunity to possess a gift. And with that gift, I've been blessed with opportunities. So I have life, I have health, I have my daughters. All of those things, I think they all converge to create what I would say is my self-worth, you know, knowing that I have love in my life. I have, you know, family.
I feel that. I love that. So if you had the chance to be in a room with three people, past or present, and you can have a conversation with them, who would the three people be and what would the conversation be?
I love these questions because these are all like manifestation exercises. Yeah. This is great.
I'm so a life coach too, so maybe that's why.
Oh, listen, I hear you working. You over here working, man. But Quincy Jones, for sure. I would just sit in a room with Quincy Jones just to, and listen to him just talk about his life. I've read all his books. I've watched his documentaries. I've, you know, in many ways tried to, you know, do what I feel he would make, some of the decision making that I think he would make, you know. But yeah, Quincy Jones is one person. Man, Sam Cooke. If Sam Cooke could come back, I would love to pick Sam Cooke's brain. You know what I mean? Because I think he was just so ahead of his time. And unfortunately, his life was cut short early. But Sam Cooke, Quincy Jones, who else? Man. Those are the two that jump out to me.
Yeah.
Those are two. Those are my two, like, they're in my pantheon for sure.
I feel that.
Who I love, you know?
I love that. I was going to say something. I just slipped my entire mind. I don't even know who I was, what I was going to say. That's besides the point. So that's what happens when you be thinking ahead, you know, and then you just get ahead of yourself. But so, oh, I know what I was going to say. So we talked about earlier about, like, you know, you're saying that, like, it would be crazy how if the producers and they had a compilation album of all the stuff that was unreleased, you know. So speaking of compilation albums, and we have, like, the DJ Khaleds that are doing stuff with different artists. Do you think that you would ever do something like that, or you would want to do something like that?
Yeah, I could see myself doing something like that for, like, R&B.
R&B, yeah, of course.
Yeah, I would do something like that. You know what I mean? listen, that would be actually fun. I've had a couple people make that suggestion to me as well, because I work with so many different artists, and it wouldn't be a hard thing. It would just take some focus, and you know, everything right now comes down to the question of having the means to be able to push it out to people, you know, especially in an age where so much is accessible to people. Yeah. But at the same time,
you
got the
right people on the, you know, I think it'll push itself out.
That's true. Yeah, I never underestimate the power of organic growth,
like,
for sure.
So I'm going to play this song because it's like one of my favorite songs right now. It was on my top 20 of 2020 last year. You already know what song it is. Usher.
Let's single. Go.
And the song, when I heard it, I was just like, oh, like, Usher's about to come back with something. Like, I heard that song and I was like, oh, his album's going to be good. Because the last album, like, granted, I feel that all of Usher's albums were good, but they just weren't as commercial or, you know, they weren't the genre that his core fans were used to. Yeah. So therefore, they didn't. You know, he might have had a number one single, but the album didn't perform as, you know, the other ones did.
Yeah.
But when I heard this record, I'm like, oh, this is going to be good. And then to hear that he's doing, like, Confessions Part 2, and I was just like, oh, like, it's about to be crazy. Yes, so what was it? Like, well, how has it been, like, working with him past and then working with him again on this record?
Every time I get an opportunity to work with Usher, it's always... He always challenges you. He always pushes you. He's just the consummate perfectionist about his art. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, this I'm excited myself just as a Usher fan to hear what the entirety of the next body of work is going to sound like. I've heard some records from it, of course, being able to. You know, be in proximity to, you know, his best friend and also one of his A&Rs, Keith Thomas, who actually is responsible for orchestrating, you know, Bad Habits and making sure that the right people were in the room, the right people heard the record. And he really championed that record to make sure that it saw the light of day. But he's played other records from the album. And I mean, it's going to be a phenomenal body of work.
Yeah, I already know. I just hope that it gets the love that it I know it's going to deserve.
We pray so, man.
Yeah, you never know. Oh, that's another question. I asked Tony this question, too, before I played the record. When you get in the studio and you're creating a record, have you ever been like, oh, this is going to be a smash? Like, have you ever just felt that and it be true or it not be true?
I guess you go in with, I think if you're worth your salt, you know, you go in with the intention to just do the best job you can, you know what I mean? And the hope is that every record you make is a smash. I mean, even though we know, you know, by the numbers and by the facts that may not be the case, but I think going in with that intention is kind of the baseline of the enthusiasm that every producer goes in the studio with, like, yeah, if we check all the boxes and make sure that it's true here and leave, like Quincy Jones always said, leave some room for God in the mix. You know what I mean? Like,
because I was listening to Tupac, It's All About You, the other day, and I'm like, this is a fucking hit. Like, I was like, did he know? Like, it's just something about it. It's just, you know, like, I don't know. Someone needs to sample that. the beat or something. Because I don't know.
I gotta take another listen.
Go listen to that record because I just something about it. Like it just feels, I don't know, good. It just makes me happy. Granted, they talking about, like, you know, hoes and whatnot. Not the lyrically, yeah, but just the beat itself. Like, it's just something, yeah, about it. It's infectious. But I do want to play Bad Habits because, I think it's a great record. And speaking of Ready for Love and then transitioning to Bad Habits, do you believe that social media is worse on relationships than before we had social media?
I mean, yes, that's obvious. I mean, social media is just, you know, it is what it is. I don't think it's good or bad, but it has some bad implications for relationships for obvious reasons. Yeah. I mean, you know, overloading your sensory perception with so many images, you know, and comparison kills contentment, right?
Yes.
So you have all these curated realities, and of course it does a number on all of us, yeah, whether we admit it or not, you know.
It's something that that's just with anything though, that you consume on a consistent basis. And I don't mean consumption as in, or you know, when you're eating anything, but just seeing certain, yeah, things, then you go to, yeah, sleep and then you start dreaming those things. And, yep, you know, it's just, it's crazy, yep, how stuff like that, you know, so you always got to watch what you speak out loud and watch what you listen to. Watch what,
yeah,
you,
for sure.
I remember, yeah, when I had the podcast with Samo, I was telling him that, one, granted, he helped me so much. His music alone has helped me so much. But I was telling, yeah, him that there's one particular song called Apology that he has. And in the beginning of the song, like, when I tell you, like, the stuff that he sings about, like, I feel like if I had a journal, he stole it. Because some, yeah, of the stuff that he's taught, I'm like, how did you even know? Because, like, that actually happened to me. When your best friend messes with your girl type stuff or whatever. In the song, like, it goes out basically saying, like, your apology's not good enough for me, you know, basically F you guys. And he's cussing in the song, and then towards the end of the song, it turns into, like, this gospel song, and he's, like, basically praying to God now, saying that, like, the next people that come into my life, like, make sure that they come from you.
Yeah.
And I used to listen to that song all the time, sing the song or whatever. And then I remember months and months later, I was talking to a friend, and he's like, oh, who do you talk to? Like, an old friend from high school. And I was like, I don't talk to nobody from high school no more. Like, I don't care about these people. And I was like, yeah, I actually have all new friends. And I was just like, wait a minute. All the friends that I have, I've met through somebody, but it all became because we were doing, like, this Bible study.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And I was just like, I didn't realize until that moment. I was like, I've been singing this song saying, like, basically all these, my next people that come in my life need to come from you. And it actually happened. And so I say all that to say, watch what you say, and watch what you put out into the earth.
you're the bastion of that right now.
Yeah.
Like, everything you talked about, literally.
Yeah.
Has either come to pass.
Yeah, and it's funny. I always would joke with one of my friends, or actually the same friend. I hit him up one day, and I hadn't talked to him in years since out of, mm-hmm, high school. And I was like, and I didn't even know he had a kid. I just hit him up and I said, are you having baby mama drama right now? And he was all like, actually, I am. Like, I'm going to court about custody stuff. And he's like, how'd, wow, you know? And I was like, I don't know. I just had a dream and I woke up and I felt like that's what was happening. And I just decided to ask you. And I was like, after that moment, I was like, I'm a prophet.
Listen. You got to pay attention to, yes, those hints there.
Seriously, though. But, like, you, yeah, it's just, life's crazy. So I'm going to play Bad Habits and then we're going to send you off. But yeah, here we go.
I love, I'm just bad at it. I just can't escape all of these bad habits. Way too many one nights, yeah. I keep messing up my love life, yeah. I love, I'm just bad at it. I just can't escape all of these bad habits. I had way too many one nights, yeah. I keep messing up my love life, yeah. Every time I think that I found the one, I turn around and then another one comes. Oh God, I
trying, baby. You should know the truth, I ain't lying, baby. Every time I see my new girl is the best. Man, I get another text from my ex. Oh God, it's like clockwork. She come through, I take her down and buy a new purse. So now you gotta pray just a little, make a way just a little. Come day up, figure it out. Don't know what all these emotions about. Keep all of these bad habits. I had way too many one nights, yeah. I keep messing up my love life, yeah. I love love, I'm just bad at it. I just can't escape all of these bad habits. I had way too many one nights, yeah. I keep messing up my love life. If you knew, I bet I wish that I could love you, baby. I keep messing up my love.
Love that record. Love that record.
Yeah. You know what's so funny is right before you played it, the guy that co-produced the record with me, Rossi, was trying to FaceTime me.
That's crazy.
I was like, he's always in tune. He's always in tune.
Yeah, that's awesome. His ears must have been ringing. So what, I know people always ask you this question, but what's next for you, or what, you know, what do you guys got coming, what do you got coming out now? And it's always a good way to just have you promote anything. But instead of asking that question of what you got coming out now, what is something that you want to have, want to do next that you haven't yet gotten to do?
Well, I mean, with Tamel, I think I'm in the middle of manifesting one of my primary goals, which is to break an act, you know, from the ground up. And after that, just doing it several more times, you know what I mean? Like just taking an artist from A all the way well into their career and really helping them.
And why haven't you come to the video shoots?
I've been tied up out here doing other projects and stuff like that. Yeah. They'll shoot a video on a whim. They'll just,
that is, it'll just
all,
true.
It all comes together really, really quickly. So if you haven't, if you don't have that freedom to just move around, you know, you have to adjust accordingly.
Yeah, that's very true. And that was like, I know when they did the Soon As video, that was the second video. I'm like, you just wasted all that money if you don't put that video out.
Listen, I mean, our whole squad has just been about this whole mantra of just chasing greatness, you know, and just being focused on that, like zeroing in on it. You know what I'm saying? Like we get up every day. We talk about this. We get on the phone. Like I'm on the phone daily, you know, just masterminding different things. And that's how we kind of lay out or cast our vision to be able to figure out our next steps.
That's funny that you said that. I had this conversation with somebody and they were like, oh, you don't talk to like some of your other friends no more. And I'm like, no, because it's not that there's any love lost, not that anybody did anything. It's just that the way my mind is set right now and where theirs is set, we're not on the same page. And if I continuously talk to people that aren't, not to say that they're not doing anything, but that are not, you know, seeking to go do something great like I'm trying to do, then I'm gonna get stuck there. So it is very important to speak with, to have conversations and talks with like-minded people or that are go-getters and trying to get something, so you can, you know.
Yeah.
So where can everybody find you?
I'm all my social media is the same. It's Pierre Medor, PIERREMEDOR. I'm there. And you can find my, if you want to listen to old music, and click on the all music link, and all new music is being promoted there. But my primary focus right now and intention is focused on Tamel.
Yes.
And I am working with other new artists, new and upcoming artists, and just helping to develop them. But a lot of them are, you know, it's a process, you know, but that's part of what I enjoy the most is working with the talent when it's just starting out and helping give them the information and the tools they need to have a successful career.
That's amazing. And I was gonna, like, when I tell you I didn't know what songs to play, I was gonna play. I was like, well, I could play All Because of You by Marcus Houston. I was like, oh, I'm gonna change by Omarion. And then I was like, and then I love the title track, Looking for Myself. But I'm just like, I'm not sure. And then I was like, there's unreleased records, Game Over by Sterling Sims.
Oh yeah, I
love that record. And then there was Now I Know by One Chance. So I had some stuff. Yeah, that I was just like,
you got Now I Know. Yeah, I need to send that to you.
Yeah, I got you.
I haven't heard that in years.
Yeah, I'll send it to you.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was going through. I'm like, what do I play or whatever? But I was like, no, I want to play newer artists. I wanted to give Shine on Tamale and Georgia Rain. So yeah, but I do thank you so much for doing the podcast. I know it's my platform's I feel like a little different than most interviews because I want people to see that you guys are more than what you do.
Man, I appreciate that.
Yeah, you're more than your talents. You know, you guys are just like everybody else. I want the viewers and the listeners to see that too. So the questions I ask aren't always generated towards music, but I'm still trying to bring it back.
Yeah, for sure. Man, I appreciate the opportunity to come on and just have some dialogue with you, man.
Thank you. Well, it won't be the last time.
For sure.
But yeah, is there any last words that you want to give out to your fans? How's it?
Man.
How does it feel to have fans?
Oh, Lord. Do I have fans? I don't know.
Definitely, you know, but...
No, listen, man. It's peace, love, and blessings to everyone, man. I hope you guys are staying safe and just being vigilant. You know, and take care of your health. Take care of your health first, you know, mental, emotionally, spiritually, all of it.
I feel it. Well, we are out, y'all. And that's all we have for you today. I hope you enjoyed yourself on this episode of Create Your Own Story with Terrell Garnett. We'll catch you next time.